Hello, welcome to Science at Sugarlands. I'm Todd Witcher from Discover Life in America. We're glad you're here. We're excited to have Jesse Webster here from the National Park Service to do our presentation today. I want to tell you a little bit about Discover Life in America. We're a partner of the park. We've been working on the biodiversity of the park, doing an inventory of the biodiversity of the park for going on 21 years now. We've discovered 1,006 new species to science, and just crossed a big plateau with more than 20,000 species documented in the park. So that just happened about 2 weeks ago. So very excited about that. We love working with the park. We love being a partner of the park. I'm going to call attention to three folks that have been helping us all summer real quickly, our three interns who've been wonderful, and we hate to see them go, but next Friday, a week from today, will be their last day. So we have Ben, who's our videography, photography intern, and then we have Gus, and we have Brittany, who they are both biology interns. So we're excited to have them, and we hate to see them go. But and then Will Kuhn is our director of science and research. He's here today, too. So thank you all for coming out. We've been doing this Science at Sugarlands. This, I believe, is our third year. We have two more. It's the third Friday of each month. And, oh yeah, I forgot you, didn't I? Julie's new. She's our new AmeriCorps person. Sorry, Julie. She just started this week, so I forgot her. We're glad to have you too. Science at Sugarlands, third Friday each month. We have different topics about the park. Today it's Appalachian bulbs, but we'll have two more this fall. One on fire soils, basically, how fire affects soils in the park, and lichens. We have a guy from New York Botanical Garden who'll be here talking about all his lichen research. We have more than 900 lichens in the park, and he will talk about his work on lichens and his new book coming out about them. So, please mark your calendar to come back again. We're glad you're here today. We have some information in the back about not only how you can support our project, but more information about something you can do in the park to help us gather data, which is called Snap It and Map It. It's our new program using your iPhone to collect data. And then there's a little sheet back there that gives you the information about the rest of our Science at Sugarlands. We'll be doing this again next year. If you have a topic you're interested in seeing us present, let us know that. We're already working on topics for next year's Science at Sugarlands. So thanks for being here. I'm excited to introduce Jesse Webster from the National Park Service. He is a great asset to the park, and he's been a great resource for us in our work in the park. And he's going to talk to you about Appalachian bulbs. So I'm going to let Jesse come up, and thanks for being here, Jesse.
All right. Thanks, Todd. You guys hear me okay?
Go well.
All right. So I work in resource management. I work with the folks that get to work with the cute cuddly bears and the elk. All those charismatic animals, but I don't do that. I work with the plants. So a lot of times I come up and do a presentation, and after the wildlife guys have gotten out there with their night vision goggles, and they got their bear skulls, and they come out with a piece of kudzu, and I think trying to show the kids how cool, you know, what we do is, it's important. But I can see a room full of grown adults here. I know you guys are all going to understand resource management, everything we do, so fisheries, fire, air quality. That's all part of the park. It's all part of the big system. So who's been to some of the Appalachian bulbs? Show of hands. All right. So I'm from Greene County, a couple counties north of here. When I was a kid, we used to look up at the big mountain there, close to 5,500 feet, and it was called Viking Mountain. Anybody heard of Viking Mountain? Yeah, so Viking Mountain, learned later that the name Viking Mountain came from a developer that wanted to turn it into a ski slope because it had some open grassy runs, and everybody in Greene County now just calls it Viking Mountain, and nobody remembers or that the old name for that mountain was Bald Mountain. So for 200 years, it was called Bald Mountain. That's what everybody, the old folks, that's what they remember it as. And I was also told by a good friend that bald actually comes from the Old English word for white as well. I think about bald eagle, the white head. So one, it was a grassy bald, but also in the wintertime, as we see here on our balds, once you get snows on them, it's much easier to see, a lot more light reflects off of that. They're even whiter. So I grew up near Bald Mountain and never thought I'd be down working in the Great Smoky Mountains, talking about balds as well here. When I was a kid, we came down with an environmental group as a camp, and we were out on Andrew's Bald, and the only thing I remember about that was all the butterflies and the beautiful views, and that's what a lot of people remember about the balds, and that's what's important to them. But what I'm going to try to talk about today is why the park finds other value and other resource value in maintaining the balds that we do have, and why they're so special, because they're really, really unique ecosystem. And I've titled this Ecological Enigma and Conservation Dilemma, and I hope by the end of this, with about four or five questions we're going to go over in depth, you guys will understand a little bit more behind that title. So we're going to talk for a little while here, and then everybody's always into a little hands-on activities. We're going to go do a little walking. We're going to take a break after about 45 minutes, and we're going to meet out front, and we're going to have a gentle stroll, because it's a super hot day. We're going to have a gentle stroll down Fighting Creek Nature Loop and talk about the forest, because we're not going to go up to Andrew's Ball today. Would love to, sorry about that, but we're going to be down here, but we're going to see a lot of the same concepts that we're discussing today. We're going to see it right outside the door, because again, the big picture, this whole park is connected. So probably just go ahead and just, if you've got a question, just raise your hand through it. It's fine. We've got some time here. We can go over this. All right. So some of those questions, how are the balds created? Why are many of the balds disappearing? And that's something we're seeing throughout the range of the balds. And what maintained them? Ben, and also what maintains the balds now? I've got a good friend who works at Blue Ridge, and you know, he really says, you know, whatever it is, you know, they're important, and he's just committed to maintaining them now the way they are. And says, why does it matter? Again, why is the park invested in managing these places? Because we spend a lot of the veg crew, and that's again, I work with the vegetation management crew. If you go out in the display here, you talk about forest insects and disease, those invasive species like kudzu. You know, that's what I do, and that's what our crew does. So we're actually, you know, part of that process in protecting these special places. So something to remember. We're talking about when you hear balds, you hear people throw that term around. There's two types of balds, right? I'm gonna typically don't like to read a lot on presentations, but there's a lot of important aspects in this, because heath balds, also called slicks, places you don't want to get off the trail. Believe me, I've had to get off of the trails. They're thick and rough. They're found along narrow ridges, and you can see those from some of our vistas. You look out on the high elevation ridges, and you can see them just right along the ridge. You'll see a dip in the tree line, and it's a little thicket. You know, they consist of evergreen shrubs. And while the formation of the grassy balds is a mystery, oh, I just gave it away. It's still a mystery. We're going to learn a little bit more about that. But heath balds, basically they're an aspect of soil and drainage and highly acidic soils too. Some of them are old, thousands of years old, deep, deep acidic soils. Those plants, like, you know, you're familiar with blueberries, same kind of ericaceae species, they thrive in those highly acidic soils, and the trees don't. So that's one reason they're somewhat open, but you have kind of a hard time seeing out on those areas. So on to what we're talking about today, grassy balds. All right, and it really gets into the definition here. I believe this is a photo from Beauty Spot. We have got our grassy balds that we maintain in the Smokies, but they're found throughout southern Appalachians. I'll get into a list of those here in a while, but this is a beauty spot, not found in the Smokies. But again, what's really important here is relatively blunt summits. That kind of plays into why experts now believe grassy balds were created and why they're still there, because they're relatively blunt summits and covered by native grasses, so not trees. So some of them, you know, of those, you have two types, heavier grass component and also a little scattered mixed hardwood component, more of like a savanna, if you've ever heard that term before. So just a few trees popping up here and there, but a lot of grasses and a lot of native herbaceous layer that just refers to a lot of different vascular flowering plants. So normally found in some of the hills, but also can be found also across slopes and down along slopes, so not necessarily on sharp peaks. So what's the big deal? What's the enigma? Why is it so strange that there are these grassy open areas at 4,000 feet up to 5,500 feet, or even taller? Remember, we got Mount LeConte, 6,600 feet now, forested, right? So there's spruce fir forest there. So what's the strange thing about these places? Any thoughts? That's it. There's no trees. And people, you know, when European settlers first got here, you know, they thought, there's no trees there. What is going on? You know, why? We have ample rainfall. There's ample soils in some of these areas. Why don't we have forest? There should be there. We know through the natural processes of forest succession, all of them throughout the southern Appalachians, they're not below tree line. Like people are familiar with the tree line out west. It's so extreme, or higher elevations and 8,000 feet plus, no trees. But we don't have that here. They should be forested. So we're going to talk about ecological succession. Now, there's two types. One's called primary and one's called secondary, but they're really all the same. Primary is an aspect of going straight from rock. Say you just had a volcanic explosion. And this is just how ecologists see the world of plant succession and forest succession. So, you know, think about after a heavy, think about, we've all got grass in our yard, right? So that's, we've started the, or some of us do, or thicker grass in our yards. We've started this process in our yard. And we know when we go out in Fighting Creek Nature Loop out here that we've got what is pioneer or successional hardwoods, and 20% of the Smokies was, quote, old growth. You know, 80% of it was cut over and logged. That's a testament to the forest to be able to heal. A lot of people don't realize the extent of logging that we had, but a lot of that was, and what's left now is in a climax forest. Have you guys heard about the hemlocks and hemlock woolly adelgid, and why we're concerned about the loss of the hemlocks? And we have other climax forest types, but that's the natural progression that we should be seeing in these areas. So early successional, the ecological term for that's even called old field. So, you know, balds are really somewhere right around here. So something is or was keeping them in this process of time. And you could, depends on where you are in the country, where you actually see the progressions. Could be 150 years to climax, could be 300 years to climax, right? So the things that start this clock continually back at one stage through this whole process of the ever-changing forest are just disturbance. And that's what foresters and ecologists call disturbance that we see. And we see that with fire. We're going to talk a little bit about the importance of fire in the forest. A lot of us are learning more about that now. Insect damage. You know, we do have native insects that set back. Southern pine beetle is an example of that. Actually sets back some of that progression and succession. Wind throw tornadoes. We've had those. Never thought we'd see a F5 tornado in the Smoky Mountains, but we did on Beard Cane Trail, 2011. So what other disturbances would create and maintain the balds?
How about humans? Just human usage.
Human usage? That's a good one, yeah. So there's a an aspect or a theory about, you know, fire itself, you know, where people actually trying to keep those open, where Native Americans keeping those open. So the theory goes now, and a lot of different research plays into this, but currently The theory goes the balds are our true balds, and we're talking a little bit about that in depth, but the true balds and the old balds, the grassy balds, they're a relic of the Ice Age. The four different, you know, there's four different glacial advances, and they're a relic from thousands upon thousands of years ago. So back when, I guess, Ohio looked like that, or most of Ohio, southern Ohio avoided that. Back when Ohio looked like that, and now we know when Tennessee, believe it or not, looked a little bit more like that. The spruce fir forest, there's records of that. Through pollen research, you can go to bogs, dig out pollen from deep down to take core samples. And we know the spruce fir forest spread out in the much lower elevations, you know, down into Knoxville, you know, found those things. So there, with those cold, drier climates, you get more grassland. And with large grasslands, you get large megafauna, right? So that's the other leading agreed upon theory. And we know from even in Tennessee, we had all of these animals here in the Pleistocene from 2.5 million to 11,000 years ago. And some of this is just phenomenal when you think about, you know, we're here now. And a lot of the story from our park, we think about European settlement and pioneer aspect, European pioneers. We don't think about the long, long history in the Smokies. So we know in the area, many, many of these animals were here, and they most likely were able to keep those open, more, again, tundra onto more of a savanna grasslands, because fire, along with large megafauna, we know now in some areas, keeps these areas into that cycle, keeps into that grassy and the forbs part of ecological succession. So we've still got some of those around, I guess, if you think about it. So what happened then? What happened 11,000 years ago? A lot of those large megafauna disappeared, right? We don't have these anymore. Like these large sloths, mastodon, and all the predators that came with it. Predators are important, right? Coyotes are moving in now, but they're helping to control the deer population. It's a good thing. So we know that, you know, that's all part of that natural balance system. You know, they had rabbits, sure, and they had something we've got now, or we used to have. Still, this little critter. A lot of folks don't know that the bison itself, not only found on the plains, but from primary counts, as far back as mid-1700s. And this is primary of documented accounts. Lieutenant Timberlake, again, he was stationed in Fort Loudoun. You guys have heard about that. Just traveling out of Fort Loudoun, listed that they were almost run over by a herd of eastern bison. So a lot of folks, we know about the elk, right? The elk program in the Smokies. We don't really think about the woods bison or the eastern bison itself. There's some debate on the size. They might have been a little bit smaller. Their coat pattern was a little bit different. It's like a subspecies that's now extinct. But we know from these early primary counts that there were thousands upon thousands, even reports from old Daniel Boone, not Davy Crockett from Greene County. Folks mix those up all the time. But Daniel Boone never wore a coonskin cap, but he did see large herds of buffalo from the Cumberland Mountain Range in Powell Valley. He listed observing thousands of buffalo. He noted that in his quote, he says, he's richer than the man mentioned in scriptures who owns cattle on 1,000 hills. So part of what supported the early pioneers on their way through these new wilds were buffalo, were eastern bison. But they were extirpated just right after this, by late 1700s. But we've got elk now. So not the, again, there was a subspecies of elk most likely in the east that's been, it's extinct. But the park's chosen to reintroduce elk This is an example of what not to do, or maybe to do, get in your car and roll up the windows. As you know, this is just right outside. This is this spring we had a couple bulls come down, maybe the second year, on their way heading to Weir Valley and then on over into Townsend. So they're moving around. They're growing, the herd's growing, the population. Part of the aspect when they originally started that program was that they would find their way to the balds and stay there. They're not doing that right now, but at some point they may find their way to the balds. So we also know, not only through the examples we have with large megafauna that most likely kept those areas open, but we know pre-European accounts, again, early colonists reporting vast open grassy areas at high elevations. Surveyors, typically they were always on the mountaintops and ridgetops, right? That's where we draw the lines. Noted that there's no shrubbage grows in the tops of these mountains for several miles. It's in the Rhone Highlands. The prospect from the Rhone Mountains is more conspicuous than any part of the Appalachian Mountains. Currently it still is. The Bald and Rhone Mountain are the largest ones maintained. Smokies specific, the Davenport Survey, 1821. Again, this is pre-Trail of Tears. So the Cherokee were here, all right? And the reports were from the first Europeans to see these areas. So they noted on their walk from Davenport Gap over on the eastern edge of the park, Indian trails going up through the gaps. Also, they blazed trees along the way, but they also noted some of those heath balds, but not the grassy balds until they get to a, quote, first bald spot, which was, we assume, Gregory, and also a second, which we assume was Parsons. So those were documented then. And also, we got the words of the Cherokee themselves. They have their own oral traditions that state a couple different stories, but one of them is that there was a giant rabbit that would maintain some of these areas, and also there was another aspect of a larger beast that would live on these higher elevations, and I think they use that to scare kids as well as one of their stories that they use. But they have an aspect of, in those stories, of these larger animals up on these balds. So also some of those are deep organic soils I mentioned earlier, not associated with woodlands, but primarily with grasslands, deep penetrating roots of grasses themselves. So I'm going to show you, and we could have had the entire presentation just on these old photographs because they're way cool. I found this great site that you guys, and I'll highlight this at the end of the presentation as well. But this is a database that anyone's free to explore, not just the GRSM, Great Smoky Mountains, but any national park. You can type in balds or cattle or cabins, and it'll spit out incredibly cool old photographs. Well worth a review. But what I want to try to show through these photographs is the progression of what we're seeing with that forest, the forest succession again that's happening. So a lot of these original photos are from the beginning of the park, once the park was acquired. So we've seen, again, if these balds have been possibly opened, created thousands upon thousands of years ago, maintained for thousands of years by these large megafauna, most likely, and then over the last 100 years or less, what's happened, and you'll see that in these photographs. So, and I've actually highlighted on that. This was the verbiage from the photos, so they'll actually come with their own documents themselves, and also sometimes who took the photograph. But this is Gregory Bald, I guess, noticing Spence in the background, Spence Field. Yeah, so I mean, again, it's a great rainy day project to get on this site and check it out. So 1939, park's already established. So hikers standing, said in knee-deep grass. So, you know, possibly that's an aspect of the bald's already starting to grow back. And it says, billowing clouds rolling through the valleys and gorges below. and Fontana Dam in Lakewood, down below. Photo is Carlos Campbell. You guys have possibly heard him. Campbell Overlook. All right. Even then, you know, and guys, have you heard of the azaleas on Gregory's Ball? All right? A lot of head shaking. Yes, I've heard. So even then, they were a value, and people noted them. And then this black and white photo, a very light lemon yellow flowers is all it said. So I'm sure it was beautiful. And it could still be up there. So that's 1936. So 37, Gregory Ball looking back to Parsons. Has anybody been to Parsons? Okay. You wouldn't know it if you went through it. All right, looking south on Andrew's Bald. So of the two balds, Andrew's going to be the closest and easiest for you guys to get to, right up by the dome, high elevation. Hemphill Bald over in Cataloochee. I've been through, and now one that's a private side is actually maintained by a group there in Moet, and it's still open. But this must have been somebody's joke from 1936 because it's cloudy and or fair. Depending on if you're in Tennessee or North Carolina, I guess. Of the two types of the balds, there's two types of grassy balds, and that's really critical in the story as well. And what I mean by that is Russell Field, and the note says that stumps bear evidence of clearing. So the bottom line is, Spence Field itself, Russell Field, they were documented, it was recorded here. John Oliver actually, you know, claims that James Spence, someone he knew, burned and cleared that area, you know, Spence Field in 1830s. So European settlers saw the balds and actually were able to get up there, take advantage of them. They wanted to open them up as well, not just for beautiful vistas, right? So they actually got up there, and we know that because these fields have plants that are more associated with cow pastures. Timothy hay, a lot of other weed species that are more associated with cow pastures over a longer time. So that's one way that we know the quote fields, and you'll hear it in the old names, folks will say field, but sometimes you'll even hear grassy bald field. People, you'll see that in the list, and you're like, how does that play into it? So they're primarily, again, two forms of these balds created. One, the original theory I told you, a large megafauna, and two, clearing by European settlers. And they really cleared them out. So they got them much more aggressive in those areas. Spence Field progressing through time, all right, back 38, pretty vast, must be in the spring. I think it looks like there's some dead trees, but I think really a lot of it's just defoliated forest in the spring. Spence Field, bare trees in 1939. On to 1969. 30 years later, this is a helicopter view, and this is from, I don't know if you guys heard some of the stories about search and rescues through the years in the Smokies, but this is search and rescue for a boy that got lost up on Spence Field back in 69, right? So of note in this photograph, you definitely many, many more trees, but look at the Jeeps, you know, these are Army Jeeps, personnel standing around. Those trees are only 15 feet tall, you know, it's not a giant forest of trees, so that's an aspect of that reforestation. So those trees have found a foothold to start reforesting that area. So how are they maintained? If those, you know, the aspect of that theory of large megafauna and all those cool giant animals maintaining them, how are they maintained afterwards? So the megafauna of European immigrants, right? So the cattle. And they saw these wonderful opportunity. We're going to get our cattle up there when it's, you know, we've got all this quality land for corn and wheat in the valleys. That's back when people grew everything they ate. And locally, there were grist mills not just for corn, but for wheat, all the other produce that pioneers, what European pioneers would have needed. So the less valuable land with ample grazing would have been these high elevation open summits. It's already there. It's perfect. Ready for grazing. Also, a little bit later in the season, a little less insects to deal with, cooler, and they could push them up there. I think Gregory himself, they had a cabin that they established up near the bald with cowbells. So I'm sure that was a bucolic scene with cowbells and a little old Europe, you know, with the cowbells in the distance. You could have heard those. So that's really what the story is. And that's the that's the transfer of those grasslands from the bison and elk and deer onto European cattle. Great story here. I think this is a good one. A friend of mine is a ecologist from the Blue Ridge. He was actually here doing his doctoral thesis, and he was working on our vegetation map for the Smokies. And Chris Ulrey, his name, is up in Nashville. And he noticed on the map these areas in the park that are called gent lines. Anybody know what that is? Heard of it? I hadn't either. But there's more than one in the Smokies, and typically they're near these balls, right? So he went up there because he's got to go to all these different forest types and actually to help with the new mapping that was coming out. And he got out there, and I said, what it looked like? He said, it looked like exactly everything else, nothing but forest. And then he came back down, but he was talking to an older guy down near Kay's Cove, and he said, man, you're up one of the gent lots. Gent lots were named for, part of the story was the white snake route. So this time of year, when people had their cattle and other animals up on the balds, they would, one of the more prolific higher elevation plants that's blooming right now and also producing a lot of fodder for the cattle is the white snake root. But white snake root has a pretty powerful alkaloid that produces a milk sickness if people actually consume the milk. I'm not sure about the calves themselves, but if they would have brought their cattle down to milk right down into Cades Cove, lower elevation areas, soon people would have, humans would have succumbed to this milk sickness. I think the story was that Abraham Lincoln's mother had some aspect of this, and it affects you long term, not just for a brief moment. So they wanted to make sure that wouldn't happen, so they developed these lots. So they would take a lot of the wood, create fencing on these areas to kind of stage the cattle halfway down the mountain, and they'd starve them. And gent is the old English word for gaunt. So they'd keep them in those lots for about 3 days, nothing. It would get that get those alkaloids out of their system and then push them on down the market. So it's pretty cool old story in these old names. There's a lot of old names out there you can't really line up the actual story with, but that's one. Again, a beautiful flower this time of year in the mountains. A lot of pollinators seem to be enjoying it. So same gent lot. These are cool right here. Yes, sir.
Was there a time period between the bison and other animals leaving and the cattle arriving? And who maintained
very the little.
Very little.
Yeah, once the Native Americans were pushed out as well, you know. Prior to that, we know there was European settlement had already started. Some of the last bison accounts in the area and elk were 1800s, just the turn. So there would have been a very brief window. And you got to figure there's almost a little leeway there for these things to get started with forest succession, because they were so well established again, it was just wide open for cattle. So this text from the old photo actually talks about, and it's really hard to see right now, it's kind of washed out. But when you look at it online, you can see this mid-elevation, a lot of whiter trees, and those were the American chestnuts, all right? So those, it's pretty cool to actually see that as part of the forest
succession story. So those were the chestnuts flowering in the distance. You can see on a better photograph of this from the gimp lot. We'll talk a little bit about that too when we're outside. Lick log. Anybody heard of Lick Log Branch up in here on your way to Gregory's? So that's an old. That's actually. I remember one of those when I was a kid up in Greene County. And in order to not waste the salt, farmers would take an axe and pop a lot of holes in a log, pour out some salt on it, and then the cattle wouldn't spill salt everywhere. But there's Lick Log Branch. There's also Eek and Eatley Gap right near Gregory's, which kind of plays into the story as well, because some of those gaps were really near some of these balls, meaning possibly Native Americans were using them as hunting avenues, knowing that some of this game would have been up on in the summertime. That's where you'd find. So, pretty cool photo. And then, not just cattle, sheep. People made everything, you know. So they made their own clothing, and there's a lot more milk production and protein production from sheep. Thunderhead Mountain, 1907, really shorn closely. Parsons Ball, 1930, looking pretty nice, pretty fat sheep. Roan Mountain, 2016. What's going on? So they used they had a project on Roan Mountain where the Forest Service had an experimental run for about 10 years. This gentleman was hired to come over with sheep and see what effect this grazing would have on maintaining these balls that they have there. I'm sure it had a positive effect. It was petting the way they wanted to, but it's got to such a size that really was outside of the scope of an experiment. And in the Park Service, we really need to go through, we want to make sure we're doing the best thing, because we've got a lot of sensitive species out there, and they want to make sure the Forest Service has the same aspect. If they have sensitive plant species, they don't want this herd of goats going over there and wiping them out. There might be some rare species up there. So that it might come to where we'll see maybe goes up on Roan Mountain, or who knows. I like to see some cattle on Gregory's one day sometimes. So we could look at pictures of the sheep all day long, a few little goats. Not this guy. So I have seen photos of the hogs up on some of the balls, but they're the, the barnyard porkers. This was the European Eurasian boars that were released for hunting that hybridized with some of those barnyard porkers and turned into what is our feral hog, and that's really an issue as part of non-native invasive pests that Park Service personnel are currently. We currently remove 300 to 500 wild hogs in the park every year. Right. So when they first started on the project in the 1980s, interestingly enough, right about the time got started on Gregory's as well with opening back up. I think they harvested over 1,200 that year. So they're really prolific breeders. If we stopped, they'd be back to the same. So it's one of the aspects, we're getting a lot better at this. But one of the problems with hogs and balls is they love high elevation balls. For some reason, and there's a couple of different wildflowers. One of them is a spring beauty. You guys heard of that? It actually has a little tuber, like a little potato called fairy potatoes. Hogs will just tear them up, and maybe it's an aspect of not as many insects, but our hog hunters typically have to go to higher elevations in the summertime, and also focal area is the balls, and we see this even in these older photos from the 70s, the ground that was turned over and disturbed by wild hogs, invasive hogs. So interesting view into the past, also an interesting view. Here's one of the park employees. We still have some clay bows on the payrolls. Rolling backside in place, but I think that was what I got a chuckle out of this, was it says, note UT weather station damaged by bears after hikers put garbage inside the station. Some things. Can you guys hear me? Yep, great. Some things never change. So there's no longer a weather station up there, one at least you can put trash in. But I got a big chuckle out of that. So what about that fire effect? That's something I really looked into. with this. It's been an area of interest for a lot of researchers that are concerned with managing moths and the dilemma that we face with those. So it's really been disproved. One aspect of fire is that it eradicates a lot of the forbs down to the mineral soil. And that's a great thing for some of our forest types, for pine forests that really need that mineral soil for the pine seedlings to establish. But what we see with the balds, and the reason we know is that there's been a smaller escape fire from some campers near one of our areas, and they tried it experimentally in Forest Service lands as well, up near Roan Mountain. And what they saw was a real influx of briars and small and tree seedlings starting up again, because it opened up that thatch layer, because we're all familiar with that. So there's a vast plant diversity on these peaks, but a lot of them are these grassy species that actually form a barrier. So they kind of have a protective aspect about them that keeps those acorns. A lot of the balds have oak forests near them. It keeps the acorns from establishing, or they're sitting there, the acorns and squirrels are able to come by and harvest them relatively easy. So we know now fire not a big aspect of the balds. However, again, right near Ekenetla Gap, you have some wonderful pine forests that we know were evolved and maintained by fire, most likely utilized by Native Americans. So vast acreage throughout the Smokies. Fire was important, but not on the balds. We can say that with core fact. So the park, there's quite a bit going on right here. So the general management plan in 82, and if you guys have been to any of the presentations at the Smokies, they might mention the Organic Act to help establish the National Park Service. But here's the dilemma with our mission in the Park Service nationwide, is we're supposed to provide and conserve the scenery and the natural historic objects and the wildlife for future generations as well. And I just mentioned that, you know, there's that aspect of forest succession, ecological succession, that's always changing. So how do we maintain something that's continually changing for future generations? You see what I'm getting at here? So how do we maintain these things in a natural state, and what is natural for the balds? So there's a lot of discussion about this in the early 80s, even knowing that there were 9 true balds that were documented, the older relic balds from the Ice Age, and also 9 others or more of the fields that were maintained by early European settlers. So the compromise currently has been to maintain 2, and that's going to be Andrew's bald, and let's kind of see the cutout right here. So Andrew's bald of roughly about 5 acres, and Gregory's bald are roughly about 14 acres. And that's the way that was set. The park said, hey, this is part of our plan. We're going to maintain them. So we also, the park was able to utilize earlier maps, those photographs that we saw. This is a layover of 1937 original boundary. And then 1975, you can see some of the, we didn't have GIS, geographical information software then. This is still in 75, we were drawing it out on a piece of paper. And then also old topo lines from Gregory's in 1944. So we've got those, and I think I'll get into the before. After 5 years of chainsaw work, and a couple of those folks are still in the park that did some of that. After 5 years, they were able to get the ball. This is a picture of Gregory's, looks like with leaf change heading into the fall. Open back up. So, this is important. Yes, ma'am.
Where do they put what they have chainsawed?
That's a great question, because it's right on, some of it's right on the edge of the woods, and that's good habitat, sometimes for rattlesnakes. But a lot of that has deteriorated, even though it's oak. A lot of that's broken down. So they try not to pile it too much, and you scatter it through the woods, and it'll eventually deteriorate. Cut them up into smaller pieces, able to get rid of them. again, you saw that one picture from Spence, the same aspect is going on up here. And I've worked up at Gregory's, and you've got stumps that you're still running over a little bit, you can still see. But this is really important. Another way that the park made those decisions to demarcate and line up where they should outline where the ball should be is the plants holding, right? So they looked at plants that were sun obligate, plants that still needed a lot of sun. They've been there, they were perennial plants, they've been there for a long time, they were fading, but they knew they needed open canopy, and they were getting shaded out. Plants that were endemic, only found there, or nowhere else in the park. Threatened and endangered, rare plants that were state and federally listed. So this is incredibly interesting because we're not the only one to say Southern Appalachian balls. However, the same aspect with predated European settlement, endemic disjunct plant populations, deep soils found in Oregon, out on the Oregon coast, and they even have the same aspect. They even called them, so instead of grassy, it already moved out west, they call them prairies. So this is prairie peak, same aspect of it, reforesting, closing in. And even in Europe, in Poland, so the same aspect of retreating of the glaciers, looks like they're doing a little bit of their job. I don't know whether it's free-range cattle, they're not as concerned about that, but they've got the same aspect where these areas should have trees on them, but they were or are being maintained, or they are currently becoming reforested. So, the veg crew's got hundreds of pictures of azaleas in the cache, but I chose some of the best because the azaleas are spent on Gregory's, and that's what Gregory's bald is internationally known, because these two azalea species right here, so the swamp azalea and the Cumberland azalea, along with two others. Has anybody heard of azaleas on Gregory's?
Yeah.
Seen them? Yeah. Guys been up there. So it's worth the hike. So those four species, and I could not get into the intricacies of how they have hybridized, but have they? Because, you know, you've got every form of, I mean, the form itself on some of the flowers, not just how the plant grows or how the flowers come out of the plant, they're different. You know, and on the notes from these photos, the veg crew kind of wrote what they thought these were. Deep crimson, and the petals themselves change. Go on, this had a little orange to it. Some of them, so there are multiple colors, forms, and fragrances. Some of them have a fragrance, some of them don't. And there's so many up there. This is like pink, yellow, you get into some, this one's a nice one. And they go on and on and on. Yes, sir.
So the term flame azalea pertains to all different colors?
The flame azalea is a certain species. It's an individual species that's found throughout the park, not those. So these are different. Their flame azalea is right in the typically look, and they require open woodland as well. And they'll be found just outside of the ball in the woods themselves. And they're beautiful, but they're not these azaleas. They're completely different. Completely different. And again, a world of colors. And people come from all over the world to see these. And that's just getting kind of gaudy right there. So that's the last azalea photo I'll show you. Well, not really. Because what maintains the balls now? Well, we do. That's Dan and Corey up there with snake chaps. All right. But so they're just highlighting some of the beautiful azaleas we've got up on the balls. But the veg crew, the Smokies personnel, hike. Yes, ma'am?
I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, go for it.
So you call those snake chaps?
Oh, snake chaps, yeah.
And your reference before?
I think those are primarily, that's just for the brush. You know,
uh-huh.
Yeah, we'll actually wear those just for a brush. It's pretty, can be some thicker areas. Some of those, some of the shrub layers, like it gets a little bit, they'll tear in your pants.
Do you think there are more snakes or reptiles in these more open areas?
I think that it's any habitat. And again, you know, this is an example of just one of those areas in the park that's multiple species, you know, unique habitat. So, I mean, you're going to find, you know, our wonderful fauna of snakes throughout the park, and they've all got importance as well.
Yeah.
So we'll touch on that a little bit later here. So here's getting up early in the morning, and Cave Cove in the distance. It's a great view in the morning. Campground 113 or 13 is right beside it. It's available to the public, so you can be camping closer to the ball to get up there. But we'll actually get up there with the DR trimmer, like Billy Goat, Tough Cut, actually clear off that vegetation. So we'll take the whole 14 acres into three different sections, and every year we'll get up there. It's 3 weeks, 1 week trips at a time, and mow down those areas. So that's how the balls are maintained. Yep, even with the grass blade from, so 14 acres with a weed eater, folks. It's a labor of love. And the camping, you think, well, that's a wonderful camp. So if you don't mind camping in what looks like it's a Jurassic Park with all two layers of electric fence, and that's for bears. So bears are a concern, but we'll leave the tents as we hike up to the balls. So we're off in the woods a little bit, and we want to make sure that the bears don't get in our tents, and they're not interested in our pillows and our sleeping bags, which they have. So we're very bear aware when we work in the park, hanging up all of our food and other gear. But we utilize these portable electric fences now, and these are great. Because before we might have problems, but this really, you know, tells the bears, hey, this is our place. And you can see multiple, one of the guys, Caleb's figure out actually how to hook the battery from the mower, a little bit bigger battery, up to this electric fence. Get a little bit more respect from the bears. But that's that's the start of the day up at Gregory's Ball. Getting up there, we can utilize pack horses. That's the pack horse called Possum. Possum doesn't look too happy about getting extra weight for the day. But those packs will bring all the gear that we need up there and all the food for the whole week. So here's the veg crew, because that's when you guys get up to Andrews and you get up to Gregory's. You know, these are the folks that actually keep it open. Yep.
So they do this
every year.
Every year for, and they try to get 14 acres.
Right. Now we can actually skip a year or two, depending on some of the areas. We might skip over a year once we feel that we've gotten pretty good coverage, pretty mm-hmm. good control. We don't have a lot. And what we're doing is we're keeping back that ecological succession and those woody species, tree species. So mm-hmm. we're after tree species. That's the main aspect. So we have become the large megafauna. We're just as we are grazing the ball.
And that machine is like a lawnmower type.
It's like a lawnmower or a bison or a mastodon in a way. That's so we're just trying to we're mimicking the process that maintains those grassy areas. So why are we doing that? Why are we going through that? You know, all the effort to actually do that. And this is why. You know, we all. Not only those unique species that we're trying to maintain and protect, but people for years, and our grandparents were a lot tougher than we were. You see this up there with their golf shoes on and their bedrolls. But people have been coming to the balls for millennia, and not just purely for camping, just for the views, and that's part of the resource. And the cultural aspect of these balls that we are maintaining. You can see a little bit of area here. We'll probably go back the next year and keep knocking that back a little bit. So, you know, one more azalea picture. I lied again. Yep.
Do you think that Gregory Ball and Andrew Ball were created by the Ice Age?
Most definitely. So those two, and again, those two were decided upon by the park to be true balls.
Uh-huh.
Therefore, those unique species, plant species, the reasons they were formed, and, you know, the AT used to go through Gregory's. I didn't know that. I don't, yeah. So they rerouted the AT just because they said, we're going to go through this effort to maintain this. You know, we're going to get too much pressure, especially with AT through it. They rerouted that. That's the reason that those two were chosen. So Parsons was a known true bald as well. That's now just about gone. You can get up there, trail goes through it, and you can get an echo of what was there, but not anymore.
Well, if Spencefield and Rustfield were cleared by farmers,
European, yep.
Surely they were somewhat clear for them.
I believe so. I mean, they didn't go up into the middle of you know, the climax forest and, you know, old growth forest and with an axe and go at it. You know, there was some aspect that got in there. And again, the balds used to range from Georgia all the way. You know, they changed by about Roan Mountain. They changed into a more northern aspect, more northern species. But I do believe that as well. But a lot of that's lost. You know, but we're not here. You know, we maintain these areas. So again, they did a interview with this Chris Ulrey, just talking about him earlier with Gantt lots. But why is the Park Service mowing down blueberry bushes at Craggy Gardens? That's on the Foothill Parkway. They got some kickback about that. And you know, why not let it return to nature? So what is nature there? You know, nature is, that's a big concept. How do we get back to that? That Park Service mission to preserve these unique species, it's a real, that's the conservation dilemma. So the ecological enigma and conservation dilemma. It's tough, but, and the quote I've got here is because there'll be usually two people up at Gregory's and they're, you know, a couple holding hands and getting ready to have lunch looking at Cade's Cove, and we come out there, sorry about this folks, four weed eaters, all day long, but only for, you know, 3 or 4 days, you know, 3 weeks, and then we're done. So it's important. So remember, this junk populations, dwarf willow, found only up on Gregory's, there's this junk population hundreds of miles to the north. Is that a valuable species? Is that a species of concern? Every species is in the park. They're all the pieces to the puzzle that we're trying to hold on to. Frostweed. I thought it would have an aspect of, you know, like the first to flower in the spring. Actually, you ever seen the? It's another one. It's called I think frost flower. It's the one of the goldenrods will bust open with some frost at the base of it. In an old field, even down here, you'll see that. That's an aspect that you're seeing here, sap being actually extruded in ice. So rare to the park, might be found in other areas, other, you know, throughout the state, but this is rare to the park. We want to hold on to all those. This is Bartonia, common name in scientific. Roan's rattlesnake root, found on Gregory, named after Roan Mountain. So not a beautiful, I mean, tiny, tiny flower. Is that important? Yes, it is, because there might be some native insects that it's the only species that they're actually keying in on. Their whole life cycle is keyed, you know, tied to that plant. Bear huckleberry, Tennessee state listed. We get a lot of bears on the blueberries up, you know, on the balls. They love it, but I'm sure they tear into some. This huckleberry might actually be producing fruit at a different time that helps feed them through the year. So we don't have the gray's lily. There was a recording from Parsons years ago. So it's been, quote, extirpated. But found in Roan Mountain. I hear it's beautiful to go see up on Roan Mountains. But they're threatened by, again, wild boar and even rabbits, maybe a lack of predators, an increase in tree canopy. It needs sunlight. A lot of these plants need sunlight. So this is about the end of it, but I thought, hey, everybody's got these bucket lists. This would be a cool one for you guys to do. This list goes on further down here. Some of these are, so this heath or grassy or young forest, fence field right here. But that'd be a pretty cool checkoff list if you guys want to go check out some of those balls. They're all pretty close, relatively speaking, day's drive. So that's it. So folks, just want to thank again, Friends of the Smokies, GSMA, and also the American Rhododendron Society. They support us every year. They help us get, you know, those mules packed up, everybody up to the top of the ball, and they've been phenomenal. They actually did a flyover photograph once when we were up there working, just with a, presented a giant photograph of the ball, because again, they love to get up there and see the azaleas. There's the link to that really cool park webpage I told you about, where you find a lot of those photos. Any other questions? Yep.
I have two questions. What is the prime time to go to Gregory's to see the azaleas in bloom? Middle of June, I think.
What's your other one?
So did I answer my own question?
That's, well, possibly you could reach out to the park too, and that depends on the weather. So it depends on how the, you know, part of that's the what's been happening. So typically middle of June, that's a great time.
Another question, Max Patch?
Main time golf course service, yep.
Is it a natural ball or is it
I'm not sure. It's a good question. Yep. I've been there before. Great star viewing area. I'm going to say those folks, sometimes they get bush hogs or larger mowers up there. So I'm pretty proud of what we do at Gregory's because it's 5 miles up there.
Hard miles.
Yeah. Yeah. And somebody walked that mower, actually. Our crew actually walked that thing up there. Yeah. Right. Yep, to get it up there back in the day. Any other questions?
Yep. You have two balls you're maintaining.
Yes, sir.
Is there any consideration in maybe doing some others? I know it's a lot of work, but.
It's a lot of work, and that's dedication to base funding, personnel. You know, it really gets into that. There have been some recent requests documented really well, a lot of the literature that I just mentioned here that really highlight the reasons to try to capture some of those other balls before it's too late. So, talk to the superintendent about that. Yep.
Have you ever seen any pictures of them baling hay up on any of these areas?
No. And a lot of times, the hay baling that went on, even up until the 40s, was a cutting and a raking. You know, I know from Green County, cutting and a raking, and they would have a field pole, and you pile all the hay around the pole, and it kind of shunts the rain off of it. So wrapped bales with twine didn't come out until the 50s. Especially the giant ones we see now.
The Sparks brothers allegedly have a horse-drawn hay baler.
Right, they do have some of those, yeah. A lot of what I think was going on there, and again, that's, they already had the fodder was on the ground ready to go. I think that was an aspect. And a lot of the cattle would have gotten something to eat on the way up there and the way down, so they had, there was some aspect of that.